Okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Though we have been using Confluence and Jira from a couple of months, today we'll be talking about project management using Jira and Confluence, and we'll look into those details which we have not discovered so far. Or some of the teams are using some of the features of Confluence and Jira, but it's not being used to its full potential. So let's begin with the content. We'll be talking about a brief recap of Confluence and Jira, what they are and what all features they have, and then we'll cover project management using Jira. So to begin with, what is Confluence? So I may not need to repeat it again, as all of our teams have been using Confluence since a very long time. So I'll just read it out. Confluence is basically a team collaboration tool built for storing, sharing and working on any kind of document. These are some of the companies which have been using Confluence and Jira worldwide. So Confluence structures our document in a very better way. So before Confluence, you can see there are n number of documents there of different types spread all across your organization, but with Confluence you can organize them with predefined or custom structures. I think since we have been using Confluence, we know what a page is, so, and what are spaces. So let's consider this room as a space and these elements as its pages. Each element has its own property. So in Confluence, every team has a space, and in each space there are n number of different type of documents fulfilling its own purpose, right? Like we have a document for meeting notes, we have reports, we have presentation slides, like that. Space and page are of different types. I'll not go into much of the details of these, as we have been using Confluence since a long time. Some of the Confluence use cases, this is to make you aware about how it is being used across the organizations in the outside world. So some of the companies or the organizations use it for technical documentation, for drafting release notes and releasing. For example, if there is a product and they want to release its notes, its documentation, they use Confluence as a wiki. So it's being used in that way. For some of the companies, say for example, who has a help desk, they use Confluence to share their how-to articles, their troubleshooting articles. So it's being used in that way as well. It is also being used by the software teams for product requirements, making documents such as product requirements, SRS, BRDs, release planning documents, customer interview pages, and for agile teams, sprint retrospectives and all those documents related to agile projects. So I'll skip this slide. This is one of the examples of drafting a requirement specification document in Confluence. At our place, we have been using Confluence for sharing all the documents since the inception of Project NVLI at IIT Bombay. We have collated and uploaded all the documents in a space named National Virtual Library of India. This space, the access to this space is typically with all the senior managers and all the associated members with Project NVLI. It contains all the MOU, letters, presentation, progress reports, etc. The other space is NVLI at IITB. Now this is again to facilitate cross-team collaboration, and all those teams which are in some way or the other associated with NVLI project, all those teams have a page by their own name, under which I think most of the teams have been creating their respective timelines and activity and sub-activity lists so far. Ma'am, 4 to 5 teams have created, yeah. So only a few are remaining. Another such space is named DBP teams at IITB. So this space includes all those teams which are not associated with NVLI but are part of DBP teams. And then there comes private team spaces. So each team has their own space with their respective name.
But Parag, I think only the teams that are associated with NVLI are really even So you should tell the other people also to.
Yeah, one very good. Yeah. Take them time to
explain.
Yeah. Then there comes another space which is named DBP staff worksheet. So here we have created predefined templates to log their daily work. Now our recommendation is that you must decide a time when you start working on a new fresh day. So let's say at 11 a.m. or something. So there you plan what all activities you are going to do for the rest of the day and what you did yesterday. And then problems faced if any, so you can simply write a to-do list in this template and then you can proceed with your working. Confluence has certain features like versioning. Now what we have noticed over the period of last 4-5 months is that most of the teams have been using Confluence, but they have been using it merely for uploading documents. So but that's not it's all about. Its main functionality is to create automated versions of the documents. So what we would suggest is that any document that you create, you must create it in the form of a page in Confluence. So however iteration it may go, it will always create an automatic version, and you can always compare two versions. If you want to backtrack to a previous version, a previous draft of it, you can simultaneously, like multiple users can simultaneously work on a document. Okay. So that way it is very helpful. Here in this,
how do you do that?
Yes, we have to simply create a page and write text there.
There
every time we save it, it creates a version automatically. No, there is a create button on the menu bar. Yeah, I'll show how to do it live. So you can see, you can when a document gets created, automatic version, it gets automatic versions. You can delete a particular version, you can even restore a particular version, and you can compare two versions. Next is plugins and macros. So now macros, I would say, are the heart of Confluence. When you create a page, I'll just show you. Yeah. Sir, we have restricted the delete permissions of all the pages. So you can only create and move, because in order to avoid accidental deletion, we have done so. Ma'am, the spaces which are private spaces of each respective team, they have all the permissions. They can add, they can delete, they can do whatever. But the spaces where multiple teams are there, where some important documents are there, there we have restricted. So a page can be created by simply clicking on this create button. If you want to use a predefined template of a page, you can click on these three dots and here you get a whole lot of predefined templates like meeting notes, product requirements, etc. Okay. Now for example, I give a title, okay, test document, okay, draft 1. I save it. I again click on edit. Draft 2, draft 3. I again save it. Now I just have to go and see the page history. You can see the version when I first saved it, it created a version. When I again saved it after a few additions, it again, see, now I can compare those versions. I can even backtrack to the first version. I have this line was added, appears highlighted in a green color. So it appears like this. So what happens is, I'll show you a document of the NVLI cloud setup project, server specification and required items. You can create a document in such a way wherein you can provide some metadata, what we call, like who is the author, what's the status of the document and what's the version. Status is helpful when a document goes through multiple iterations over the time. So initially a document may be in draft phase, a document may be in review phase. For example, if it's a report and if it has to be reviewed by the hierarchy, by the senior people in the hierarchy, then it may be in the in review process. So this status can be changed, and lastly you can mark it as freeze, then the document is ready. Okay. Now as per our slides, our next thing was macro. So I said that macros are the heart of Confluence. So apart from the basic functionality of creating spaces and pages and all and different types of pages, there are whole lot of other options. For example, the timeline what you create using a roadmap planner macro, so it is one of those macros. You can create spreadsheets using macro. You can mark a status of a document using status as a macro. So these are some of the macros. I'll come back to my slides.
How did you get to the macro?
Yeah. So in any of the document or the page that you have created in Confluence, just click on edit and then you can see a plus sign over here, right? Just scroll down to the bottom and you will see other macros as an option. You'll get a, okay. So this is how we create a macro. So there are other very useful macros as well, like you can create diagrams, block diagrams, etc. using Gliffy. Sometimes what happens is when you in your organization, there are repeated documents and there is some part of the text which keeps on repeating. So you don't want to type it again and again. For example, template that we created for report. So some part, heading, header or footer keeps repeating. So there are macros named excerpt that can help us reusing that content. Okay. Then I skipped the macro.
The excerpt can be edited.
Pardon, ma'am?
Can the excerpt be edited?
Yes. Basically, whichever content gets repeated, we save it in a form of an excerpt and then we use, then we call that excerpt in that document again.
Yeah, what I mean is, yeah. Can the excerpt also be edited?
Yes. Every time it can be. Then we can label documents, so we can categorize documents in that way. And then there is a macro named label list, so I'll just show you. See, when we preview, although right now I have just added it at some location, not a proper location, but this is how we can, when we label all the documents, then we can get a labeled list, so it becomes very much easier to navigate those documents. Okay, different kinds of documents, like say in operations lab, sir must be having n number of different kind of documents, so you can label those documents with their category. And you can have a list of those documents here as a macro. Again, labeling those documents, and even if you do not label it, Confluence has got a very good search feature. wherein you can quick search just by typing initial few initial letters of your of the name of your document, and it even search within the text of your document. So either it may be a Word document, a text, a page, whatever it may be. Then there is another very good feature through which you can share knowledge among your teams, that's blog functionality in Confluence. Now our team had been publishing blogs in the space named DBP at IITB. I think none of you have read those blogs so far, but we have been we will be publishing more of such blogs, and we would even appreciate if some other teams come up with their own blogs and their own topics on which they want to share knowledge with all the DBP team members. I'll show you where they are.
Send out a notification.
Yes, yes, yes. We'll be doing that. So this is how a blog appears. On the sidebar, we can see an option named blog. If we click here, we'll get into all those blogs which have been published so far, and on the right we can get their respective content. So I'll be keep swapping live demo and the slides in order to get a better feel of that. This is how they appear. You can even like, comment, not subscribe, only like and comment here. Okay. So you can share your own thoughts on the blocks. Okay. So initially what you can do is you can start with writing blocks in your private team spaces, and later on you can move it to the team which has access to all the teams. We as a project coordination team would recommend that you create documents as in the form of pages in Confluence itself. You can skip a few, there are exceptions, like creating these slides would not have been possible in a better way in Confluence, as we need to present it, and those functionalities are, that tool is not meant for that, but you can always upload it in the form of a file. But for rest of the documents, like creating Excel sheets, any other documents that you can create using that, you can collaboratively work on a document, multiple users can work. And though I have covered a very few macros, but I would recommend that you please explore other such macros. Even if some macros are not listed there, and you may find it on Google that okay, these macros are also available, then we'll ask our CSAT teams or our Jira and Confluence administration team to configure those respective macros for you to use. So if there are no further questions, then I can move on to Jira. Okay. So Jira is basically a project tracking and project management tool. It is developed by a company named Atlassians. I'll skip these slides. So how it helps? It helps in better planning, in better tracking, releasing and reporting. Some of its benefits are that it's massively scalable, and it has n number of add-ons. Like we had macros in Confluence, here we have so many number of add-ons which adds to the functionality of Jira. Some of them are big picture, Jira portfolio, agile, tempo timesheets, etc. Though we have not we are not using all of these. So what a Jira project is? A Jira project is a collection of issues and is defined according to your organization's requirement. So for example, we have different teams serving different purposes. So we have Jira projects for all other teams. Okay. Now we have a combination of teams. We have some teams which are specifically into software development, while other teams are non-technical teams, are some business teams. So a Jira project can be for both kind of teams or any kind of teams, whichever domain they may be serving in. Okay. Like they may be HR teams, operation teams, or in case of software, they may be a development team, they may be a website enhancement team, etc. Now what an issue is? This term sounds a bit ambiguous to many of those who are very new to Jira. Okay, so an issue in the simplest terms is a unit of work to be done. Okay, so you can also swap it with the word task. So an issue is can be also called a task by default, and it is a unit of work to be done. For example, creating a purchase order is an issue. Book the conference room for meeting is an issue. Develop the mock-up for homepage of a website is an issue for a software development team. Now, an issue is a unit of work to be done, and it can be, it can have different types, like a work to be done is can be a task or it can be a subtask. Okay. So for all the teams which are not software teams, we would recommend that they use only these two types to start with while creating an issue in Jira. So their issue will either be a task or a subtask. For other teams, let's say for example Shweta ma'am's team's team is using agile practices. So there the issue can be an epic, it can be a story, it can be a task, it can be a subtask, it can be a bug, etc. Next comes an issue workflow. Now let's understand it in a very you know, real life terms. Whenever we do a task, whenever we get a task, for say from Fatak sir, if a PR team gets a task, firstly they get a task, then they understand the task, then they actually do something to in order to complete the task, and at the last that task gets completed, right? So it transitions over different status. Initially it is in to-do state, then it gets into in progress, and then it ends finally as a done, right? So every project has a predefined workflow in order to complete their tasks. This workflow can always be changed. For example, there may be for example in operations lab there may be some additional steps like sending file to DRMM or getting file to be signed, or it has to be reviewed. Okay, so we can identify a proper term for that. So that way we can set a task life cycle which is named as workflow in Jira. Okay, so any questions so far? I would like to know. Let it be an interactive session, feel free to ask. I will try my best to answer all your queries. If not right now, after the session I will try to. Yeah, so I am coming in that. So these were some of the basics. Now let's understand what a Jira issue is again, what all fields are required to create an issue, then we will see a live demonstration of how to create an issue. So first thing, a point to remember is that whenever we create an issue, its title or the summary must be well defined. Sometimes what happens is that user create an issue, but they write its summary in such a way that it's very vague, it's very ambiguous. For example, one issue is named simply a meeting, or simply send attendance. Now, what you can figure it out only by reading send attendance. So these are some bad examples, and some good examples would be that send list of staff attendance to IRCC for the month of November 2006. Now you can properly make some sense out of the summary of this issue. Another one is organize meeting with NVLI cloud setup team to discuss the status of stage 1 and decide activity timelines of stage 2 and stage 3. So to summarize, your issue title or summary must be well defined. These are some of the Jira issue fields which are very much important in order to create a proper issue and later on to generate some meaningful reports out of these issues. Okay. So whenever we create an issue, okay, this let me show you live. Again, like we create page in Confluence by using the create button, The same way in Jira, using the create button, we can create issues. Okay. For example, I'd like to create an issue for the project NVLI cloud setup. Now you as a user will, when you will open this list, you will get to see only those projects to which you are associated with. Okay. So first you have to choose your respective project, then your issue type. So in your case, only two options will appear, one task and another is subtask. Then you have to write your issue title here in the summary field. All those fields which are marked with a red asterisk sign are mandatory fields in order to create an issue. This is self-explanatory. Okay. Then you can skip to write detailed description, or you can even write it later. Okay. Reporter is the one who is creating the issue basically, and the assignee is the one whom you want to work on that issue. Reporter and assignee can be the same person also. For example, I'll choose myself as the assignee. Okay. Then comes the component. Sometimes what happens is that in a team there are work happening in multiple domains. For example, I would like to put it in a way like workshop team. Now workshop team has one team which organizes workshop, which plans workshop, and the another team is the software team which develops a platform to facilitate that workshop. Now all those issues, say for example over the time of 1 year you have created 2000 issues. Now if you want to filter those issues, how you will do? So you can create two components to logically group your issues. You can create one for workshop software team, one for workshop team. Okay, we can name it in a more better way. So component field is for logically grouping those issues. Then comes the original estimate. Okay. Now this is very much important that you all must fill while creating an issue. Now this is the time required to complete an issue. Yeah. Then comes the start date and end date. Now so this is again very important, and in order to create meaningful reports you must put a start date and an end date which you think an issue will take to complete. Then there are two other fields that we will discuss in the upcoming slides. One is risk probability and another is risk consequence. Though I will be sharing these slides, but you can always note down whatever you feel is important. So I will reiterate that start date, end date, a proper summary, an assignee, original estimate. These fields are very, very much important in order to create good issues and to generate meaningful reports later on. Okay. So this is how an issue looks like in Jira. On the top you can see there is a number, NVLI 63. So this is basically a unique key. Every time a issue is created, it gets an automatic generated unique identifier. Okay. So this is the 63rd issue created in the project NVLI. This NVLI is a key for the project NVLI. Okay. Now as I said, the title of the issue should be meaningful. So here I want to make multiple selections so that I can make annotations for different contents in the image. So this is one functionality of the Drupal webs, NVLI website that was ongoing few months back. In the details section you can see the detail of your issue, for example what type of issue it is. So here in your case it will appear either task or a subtask. You can see the status of your issue, whether it is just been created and has a status of to do, or it's in progress, or it's done. When it's done, its resolution is also set to done. You can also label issues, like you can label documents in Confluence, same way. Okay. If there are any subtasks, of that particular issue, they appear in the section of subtasks here, wherein the summary of the subtask, whom it is assigned to, and what's its status. Here in the people section, you can see who is the assignee, who is the reporter. You can choose to be a watcher of that particular issue if you would like to receive email notifications for any changes in that issue. Okay, there are dates, so whenever an issue is created, that date appears over here. When it is updated, it appears over here. Start date and end date is the resolve date, both are the same. Work log, right? Where, ma'am?
Beside the green sign, beside done.
View workflow. Yeah, so it's the same basically in the slide which I display. I'll just show.
No, I just thought we could see a live.
Yes, I'll show you. This is a one such workflow. To do, in progress, and done like that. So it can again be redefined, but the recommended practice is that when you initially create a project, when you set up a project, okay, with the help of the admin teams, only that time you define a standard workflow. It should not change once the issue gets once you start working on that project. So these are some of the things which have to be.
Do you define the workflow?
No, these are the default. This is the default workflow.
Automated, right?
Yes. Okay. So then comes the time tracking. In the next slide was the time tracking thing. Okay. So while creating an issue, when we fill in the original estimate, that appears over here. That estimated time is 1 week, 1 day, 5 hours. Remaining time, when we first create the issue, it's the same as the estimated time. When the user start logging their work, then it gets changed. Then the log time and remaining time automatically adjusts, okay, with respect to each other. Subtasks again are appearing over here. You can see. This is the main task, and these are the subtasks in order to complete that task. All have been done. Okay. Here you can see comments on that issue. Work log, I will be explaining it. And any activity done so far with respect to this issue. Yeah, so it can be reopened if required.
Not reopened, you can just drop it.
No, dropping means what? You are changing the state.
The issue to some other team. Later on we realize that it is not changing.
Okay, so it will be on the records. Yeah. You are not deleting it. You may flag it with something that, okay.
Unresolved or something.
Yeah. Or irrelevant, or so your efforts are not being wasted actually. You can comment on that issue and you can put it. Yeah, I'll show. In your scenario, it must be happening, yeah, very frequently. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, so you can see a comment button near the edit button. Simply you have to click on this comment, and that comments get added below the issue. Or we can create a separate field, okay, we will call it a flag, and yeah.
Yeah, that would yeah. be better.
And we can,
because a comment one will have to search for it.
Right. So later on if you would like to search all your irrelevant issues, but you had spent some time on it, you can search them using that filter as a that field as a filter flag. Yes, yes. So these were some of the issue fields, and this is how typically an issue looks like. Another field which appears over here is development. This is for the software teams. So there is a Git integration available in Jira. So all those teams which are whenever they check in their code in Git, they simply have to take the issue key and mention that in their commit message. When they do so, it automatically gets appears over here in that issue in Jira. GitHub, yeah, the one which is hosted outside. Okay, so even that is possible. Since we had not received any such requirement as of now, so we have not configured it. Yeah. Yes, yes, it can be configured for local Git as well. Yeah. Okay. So this is how, when you click on the commits or the branch, it pops up. And you can see who was the author, what was the message, date of the commit, files, etc. Okay. So, any questions so far? Yeah, sure, sir. Yes, yes, it can very well be done. Would you like to see it? Yes. So, when it's created, whatever options you can do with the issue are only on these two buttons. One is more, okay, and the another is edit. Edit is basically to edit some more fields. More is to do some more tasks with respect to that issue. Now you would like to link an issue with some another issue, so you simply have to click on link. Now in order to link it, you have see hell lot of options. Has to be done after, is blocked by, is cloned by, is dependent on, depends on. Okay, so this is how you can link an issue. So, any more questions? Yeah, ma'am. Okay. 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 Yeah. So. Yeah. So, in that case, if you have if your project requirement is such that there are multiple teams involved, then we can configure it in such a way that both the team users will be associated with your Jira project, and you can then change the assignee. Every issue has an activity log, right, wherein whatever change it goes through gets listed. So if say for 1 month your team members are working, fine, it's on the records. If after a month another team is working, that's also on the records. So it can be done. No, even if he doesn't say, if a assignee gets changed, it gets recorded in the form of a log there. But you can always comment that changing the assignee. Yes, yes. So what we'll do is we'll set up a common project for your team. Okay. Yes, yes. I know. Maybe we can what we can do is, we can, after the session, we can work around with your requirements, or our team will visit to each team in person and we'll find out, because each team will have different requirements. Yeah. So we'll visit each team and then we'll get your requirements, and then we'll customize the Jira projects or set up the Jira project or Confluence space the way it fulfills your requirement. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Differ. Okay. So now we will look at Jira Confluence usage flow. So basically, this flow we have identified. We have been we had been using it with the vendors all as well. This is the flow that we recommend to the NVLI partners as well. Although you have always the liberty to modify this flow. But as of now, this is our recommendation that you must follow this workflow to begin with. Hello, sir. So initially, what happens is you create documents in the form of pages in Confluence. Okay, the document goes through several iterations that you can always see in the form of versions. Okay, once the documents is freeze. Or it's frozen. You also conduct some meeting. Okay, you organize a meeting, your intra team meetings. When you conduct a meeting, you come up with meeting notes, right? So we recommend that you create those meeting notes in Confluence using the predefined template of meeting notes. Okay, for example, for the project NVLI cloud setup. We had conducted two meetings and we had created two meeting notes. So when you draft meeting notes using the predefined template, you can write the discussion items over here, okay, and based on these discussion items you can figure out the action items to be done based on these meeting notes. You can simply write what the action item is, you can assign it to a user using the @mentions in Confluence, and you can write a due date. Okay. Once that task has been done, you can simply put a check mark. Okay. So this is a lightweight project management, but in order to track the individual progress of each issue, the time tracking, for that we will have to use Jira. So I'll again come back to our recommended usage flow. Once we are done with creating meeting notes in Confluence, then we create activity timelines based on these meeting notes. Okay. And we also create a detailed activity and sub-activity list in Confluence based on these meeting notes. Then you have to create Jira issues from Confluence. We'll go through all these steps one by one in detail. As of now, I'm just reading out these steps. Then you edit issue fields in Jira, you update issue status regularly, you get and receive issue event notification, then being a manager, you manage programs using Big Picture add-on in Jira. You also use dashboard and gadgets to track your project progress, and at last you generate meaningful reports. So let's see step one. So create, yeah, yes sir, yes sir.
I'll go back and fix a lot of work.
Yes sir.
So I hope you are following all this. But let me tell you from my own experience that it takes some time for you and your team members to get used to. It's not as if you do this once and then. So you have to dirty your hands. So two important things. Firstly, what process is outlined is the one process through which you can actually get your timelines and so on. It is entirely possible that you yourself write down the activities along with that. So there are no meetings, no meeting notes, nothing. But you can actually create those independently. You can create them directly in here.
There is one easy way of doing things where the activities flow out of the meeting. Usually in the agile methodology of programming, the software requirement specifications themselves emerge in this fashion. And that is the reason why I say that the requirements will emerge through discussions. So it's quite possible that for a small project or even for a large project, just the team leader sit down and identify some activity. You know, always add more activities and always add more sub-activities. It's possible to create. That is one important. The second important point is that the entire mechanism of tracking depends heavily on each individual team member updating daily activities. Now this is something that we are not used to do. You probably update things once in a week or something like that. Once you get used to it, you will find that you need not spend more than 5 minutes at the end of the day to say this is done, this is not done, what? In fact, have you described the 5 minute standing meeting that are generally done?
Yes.
So that could be a good point to do in the morning, where these minutes, these meetings are actually not this long discussion meeting like this. These are actually standing meetings, meaning people actually stand, not permitted to sit. Because if you sit, a 5 minute meeting will extend to 20 minutes. There is no cup of chai, no nothing. It's a 5 minute, very crisp meeting. What was done yesterday, should be done today, what difficulties I face. That's it. You note, everything notes it down and done. In exactly the same way, at the end of the day, each individual person must spend 5 minutes in updating the record. If this is not done, the whole mechanism of project management will flop. So the project management depends upon whether inputs are coming every day on the progress made or not made or whatever. We're not setting this up as any kind of policing activity. We are setting this up to improve our own productivity, collectively. Individually we are productive, but collectively we improve productivity. That's all I wanted to stress. It will take some time for everyone to get used to it. But I want every team member, except those who are at the lowest level as the attendants or someone who cannot figure out how to type in their thing. Although they should also be trained to write something, if they have any task as part of it. But otherwise everybody has to follow this. Any other issue that has come up through your discussion so far? Or you are still going through that?
We have been clarifying.
Yeah. So the point is that Jira and Confluence have been used extensively for software project management. Redmine is a general project management tool which our partner CDAC uses. But Redmine reports, etc., can be actually imported in Jira.
Right.
So they have agreed to use Jira also.
So even for nowadays it's widely used for non-software projects as well.
Yeah.
And when we had updated the Jira version, the hosted version of Jira, yeah, it now when you create a new project, it basically gives you two categories: either your project is a software kind of a project or it's a business project. So we have all kinds of team, so we can actually utilize it to its maximum potential.
What I am looking forward to is not software project management.
Yes.
That would be done by a few teams which are involved in software development, and they can actually create a parallel project for software development. But all of them must participate in the general business project, which deals with the timelines of activities and completion and so on.
Right.
And it is the general project management that they are talking about. So please try to assimilate as much as possible. I know it will be difficult because we have never done that thing. We rarely write. We don't write our diaries. Here we are saying everybody must write a diary entry every day. Now, usko assimilate karne ko time lage. And then people say, I bhul gaya, ye ho gaya. So this activity has to be treated like your dinner or evening tea. You don't forget to have either.
Yeah.
So you cannot have your evening tea unless you have written one line or two lines of the ring. It's as important as that. Raat ko khana nahi khana chahiye. Jab ye agar entry nahi hua hai, toh no dinner. So that is the discipline that we'll all.
I would like to remind that as part of the our project proposal, we are needed to share a dashboard, a live dashboard of our ongoing projects as well as reports. So until and unless we do not put such some meaningful data
issue until unless we do not make an entry against an issue. Yeah.
So it is not only us, the people in the ministry would like to monitor how the project is progressing. If they can't monitor unless the progress will report. So unlike old times where you remember there is a PRSG meeting where every 6 months or 3 months or 4 months we report the progress in overall. So that meeting happens only once in June. At that time external members look at the overall project and comment. But this is minute project management and minute observation. The Secretary, Ministry of Culture, should be able to look at the overall project. If he so wishes, he may click, may go to the details. And I will not be surprised if he calls me someday and tells me that Fatah, your workshop team, for example, is goofing up, certain activities are not yet done. It is to that level we have to expose ourselves and our. Big brother will be watching. The whole idea is to make the process transparent. It is not, the purpose is not to fire anybody or something, but to get used to increase correctly. All right, I'll leave it to.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
But this is obligatory now. There is no shortcut. Everybody will have to do this.
Yeah. So now we'll be seeing the recommended usage flow in detail step by step. So step one was to create requirements specification or other documents as pages in Confluence. As Professor Fatak said that a team may not be conducting internal team meetings to find out the requirements or to find out the activities and sub activities. So based on the nature of your team you can proceed. So organize internal team meetings, then you can draft and share those meeting notes in Confluence. You can identify action items and assign them to a user with a due date, and this is what we call as lightweight project management. This can be done using Confluence. Okay. For example, last week when we conducted a training session in CDAC Pune, we came up with these notes. And then based on these notes and the discussions we did there, we came up with these action items. Okay. Like they need to create a timeline in Confluence and a list of sub activities. So not even not only our internal teams has to do this, even the NVLI partners have to submit a timeline of next 2.5 years. This is a mandate by the ministry. So this is how we identify action items. These all tasks are dependent on me. These action items are dependent on CDAC users. These are again the same slides. The step third is create timelines based on these meeting notes. So timelines using the plugin roadmap planner can be created. Okay. And I think most of you have worked on this macro, so you know how it appears. Right. This is how a timeline appears. Next is creating a detailed activity and sub-activity list based on this timeline. Your timeline may not have a detailed list of activities, it may only have goals in very brief form. So we recommend that you create an activity and sub-activity list in order to complete the tasks listed in your timeline. So again, activity and sub-activity list can be simply created as a Confluence page wherein you can list all the tasks and subtasks. This is one such example of a sub-activity and activity list. For example, we had conducted a meeting. We for NVLI cloud setup, we had identified action items, we had created meeting notes, we had created a timeline, then we came up with a activity and sub activity list. Now why it is useful, that we will get to know in the slides ahead. Next step is create Jira issues from Confluence. And you can read the point number 2, that how simple it is. It is as simple as eating a vada pav. Why it is so simple is, which wherever in whatever form the text is in Confluence, you have to simply drag and select it. As soon as you do it, it pops up you with 2 options. Either you create a issue or you write an inline comment. Okay, I'll show you how. Say, for example, I want to create this issue. I'll simply select it, I'll wait, and I get 2 options. Either I add an inline comment over here or I create a Jira issue. Now whichever project to which I am associated with, I'll get all those access. Okay. I'll select only the basic fields over here and I'll click on create, and the issue gets created. Further, you can go in Jira, you can open that issue and you can click on edit and fill in the rest of the fields. So you can create issues from Confluence in Jira directly from the timeline itself or from the activity and subactivity list, the detailed list that we created. Okay. So it becomes too much very simple. This is how you get to see all the issues in your project using issue navigator in Jira. This is the issue navigator. This is the issue navigator. Okay. Next step is to edit and update issue fields in Jira. So again, all those fields that we discussed in the previous slides, the important fields, you have to fill in those fields, which includes original and remaining time estimate field, start date and end date. These are very much very important in order to create meaningful reports. This is how you can edit an issue field. You can simply click on edit button and you get to see all the fields. Okay. Start date, end date, original estimate, reporter, assignee, components. Okay. So if you are creating an issue from Confluence to begin with, so that time you will get to fill in only a project summary, that's all, but you have to fill in rest of the fields. Yeah. Then again, as the issue or the task will progress, the assignee in particular will have to update its status. Initially it will be to do, then it's the assignee's responsibility to change it to in progress when he or she actually are working on that issue. And lastly, when it is done, when the user has logged the work against that issue, then they will mark it as resolved or done. So then a user or the assignee to which the issue is being assigned, he or she
can go automatically, like when we have an action and we have assigned the action and when the action is completed, then can it go directly there that the action is completed here, then the issue gets completed automatically?
Actually, we have not worked with such a requirement, so maybe we'll have to.
Confluence when that action is there, then we create action and we assign it.
Yes.
And once the action is completed, we put a tick.
Yes.
Then that is completed.
Yes.
So like here, we can create an issue for with that action. So can it connect, like when we put a tick here, then automatically it changes the status to done?
Probably not. And we have not actually, this use case we have not explored. So maybe we can try and then we can see what the result is. Yes, yes, ma'am. It's a single sign on. So, yeah.
So then this facility that means once we take it here, then it should automatically move.
Yeah, but you know, you say we have to check it.
Yes, yes. Right. Right, right. And it may be even, there may be more such transitions. Yeah.
More tasks for one issue.
Right.
That also is
yeah, yeah. So the status can be many. It cannot be only start and done. Yeah. So good point. So next step is log the work against each issue. Now, being a user of Jira and being a signee, it is very much important, as Professor Fatak also said, that you need to log your work at the end of the day. Okay. So, for example, if a task in Jira has an estimate of 2 to 3 days, so we would recommend that before marking it as done, you must log the work against each issue. How this logging of work happens is, so as I said, that all the options that you will get with respect to a Jira issue will be in these two buttons. One is edit button and another is more button. Yeah, so you have to simply click on log work. As soon as you click on log work, you will get a pop up. Okay. I'll show you. When you click on this, so say for example, an issue was assigned to me, which was supposed to be done in 3 days, okay, it's a 3 days long estimated issue. Now this is my first day and I spent 1 day on it, okay. 1 day is considered as 8 hours here in Jira by default, okay. Then I'll put the date started and remaining estimate is adjusted automatically. Now work description here I can put that what all things did I did today in order to complete that issue. Then I'll simply click on log. Okay, as of now I'm not doing that. Now all these work log will appear over here. The user Vimal Joseph logged the work on 20th June at this time. The time spent was this, and whatever he wrote in the comment is this. Okay, so. So, yeah.
So that's why I wanted to know whether we should use Confluence or.
Yes, ma'am. So what happens is. Yes, yes. Yeah.
Yeah, because the daily log, whether we should put it in Confluence or in Jira.
Yeah, so even Fatak sir mentioned the same thing, like whenever we start a day, okay, so we plan the activities of that day, right? That's what we do in the daily stand up. If your team is, yeah, so if your team is very small in size, you can even conduct that meeting by sitting on the chairs, okay. But the idea is to discuss what are you going to do for today, what you did yesterday, and were there any blockers or problems faced, right? So when you plan for say 10 tasks to be done on that day, it may happen that you may not be able to complete all those tasks, okay. So you have a log of that, a to-do kind of a list there, and here specifically you are mentioning, okay, for this activity I put this much effort, and so I am logging that effort with against that issue. So this is how they are different. And Yes.
So you have to come up with a solution.
For Jira logging, in the work logging, Jira, there are not so many ways to do.
No, I am not saying that.
At the end of the day, you have to write how many time, how much
time. The only thing is repeat. What she is saying is
repetition of work.
Yes. So, ma'am, in order to resolve it, I'll suggest you a practice. What you can do is, when you conduct your daily scrum and when you come up with your activities, you simply note it down in the daily staff worksheet, that space in Confluence. You can simply drag and drop to create an issue in Jira. Once it is done, If it is done, you have to simply mark done at the end of the day. If it's not done, you have to just log work and write the comment, okay, this was the activity I planned, but I did only this, this, this with respect to this issue. That's it.
Morning we are doing this, next day we come and say yesterday we did this, right. And it has not completed, so the same thing will be there, that this much is done, right. The same thing, the worker of course it will be the same,
so
thing here, in Jira also.
You don't have to write the description, you have to write the amount of time spent so that when the reports are generated, mm-hmm. we come to know how much time is left for that task and what is. If you don't log the time, then there is no need for start time and end time.
As a Confluence, you don't get that.
So this.
It's
not a 5 minute thing. The deadline is there, tomorrow it has to be released and so many bugs are coming and all, and if I ask my staff to do this, they will not do it. They will do it.
This is also part of the work, and if this is not done, then your task is anyway incomplete. There is also that 5 minutes is also needed.
So can we do it once the work is completed, no. Monday we sit and we bill it?
No. So that would mean that, you know, after the end of the project you are filling up Jira in the story.
Actually, we will have to inculcate all these practices.
Even Confluence, now we are used to it. So we just come, we will just like, we check mail, we do that. So we will just put whatever is there. Now, this is the additional work. That is what it is.
No, as of now, it appears to be an additional work.
That is for software team, right?
Yeah.
So that is a different thing. Most of the teams are not software.
Mom, it's 20 minutes
and
from now.
Anyways,
I'll be resharing these slides.
Even in that the code management system what we are using CMS, that can be integrated with that. No, as we use that, so.
Oh, if you integrate
SVN, then it will automatically. Oh, SVN. When
they
are
committed,
then
it will automatically.
According to that,
you can,
you will get the report next
much
time they work,
then
when they go, you will
get
the
report.
SVN.
Yeah, so there are like multiple options. You can integrate SVN itself.
Replication.
Yeah.
Replication,
yeah.
Of
so
that's the only thing.
Yes, yes. So it appears to be replication as of now, but we can.
We commit the code and it is integrated with that, but then the request goes to them and they move the.
Now the problem is according to your requirement it will work. According to suppose account team other team, then it will
work.
Yeah.
Their problem.
Yes.
Right.
That is
right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that is why I feel means it's a repetition problem. Mm-hmm. So committing the code, writing the all those things we are writing in SVN. SVN is configured here. Then that can be done, but I don't know how the code management system.
Code management will not.
Will
only
not.
SQL.
Only SQL.
Or Git.
So. Once the user logs the status, once the issue is marked done or the status gets changed, next step is to receive issue event notifications. Okay, so anytime there is an update in an issue, be it the issue creation itself. Or B, the issue gets updated, an issue work log has been done against an issue, all those notification you can choose to receive. Now these notifications, we have set up a dedicated Slack channel for each team, okay, to receive Jira and Confluence updates specifically. So you can either choose to receive it there, or you can we can enable email notifications for your team to receive Jira updates. Okay. Now in the last few steps, one is program management using big picture in Jira. Okay. So program is basically a level higher in hierarchy than Jira projects. Yeah. Yes, yes. Yes, yes. Yeah, so this is actually a very important part in facilitating project management using Jira and Confluence. Okay, program management. We have a plugin named Big Picture in order to do that. Yeah. So I would like to show you. So this plugin, big picture, is used for portfolio and program management. Okay. For example, a program for NVLI cloud setup. Okay. It has four modules: Gantt, roadmap, resources, risk and teams. So this is very, very important in order to manage your project. Okay. So we'll get into the details of this add-on, big picture, in the next session. Just as a brief reminder of one thing, you remember I had shown activity and subactivity list of NVLI cloud setup project. Here it is. Yeah, here we had identified stages: stage 1, stage 2, stage 2, stage 3. When we create a roadmap in this plugin, you can see we can use those stages as phases and we can put in those issues in each respective phases. It's a little new for teams here, but I'm sure we all can do it. No, you any. Thank you everyone.
We'll catch you after practicing.
Yes, ma'am.